hit my button on this. daughter of Trent? Where's your Kleenex?
Remain standing as we continue to worship you. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
This week, all regular activities in the church are happening. Prayer meeting on Tuesday nights, Wednesday nights. Everything that's happening before is going to happen again. This afternoon, 1 o'clock here in the sanctuary, our marriage conversation is going to continue. We welcome you to come to that. Old or young alike, it doesn't matter. If you're married, that's really probably the only requirement. Or if you're engaged to get married, come and join us in this conversation. Church board meeting Tuesday night, 7 p.m. Young at Heart Fellowship Group, Saturday, March 25th, Taco and Pictionary Night. Sign-up sheets in the foyer. Garage Keepers, Life Group for Men, next Sunday, 7 to 8 p.m. 7 to 8 p.m., sorry. Youth and Family Retreat, March 31st, April 2nd. If you have any interest in that whatsoever, if you see Pastor Barb or Pastor Melissa, they can fill you in on the details. And I think we're getting down to the wire and needing to know if you're wanting to go. We kind of need to get that finalized like ASAP. And the ladies' luncheon, April 1st, sign-up sheet is in the foyer. That's the extent of our announcements. So if the ushers would come, prepare to take our offering, we will pray for that and receive that. Dear God, as we bow our hearts to you this morning, Lord, we are prepared to worship you with this act. Lord, we collect our tithes and offerings, and we bring them to you with intentionality and purpose, out of obedience. Lord, sometimes it's out of a desire to see you move in our lives. Maybe it's an act of desperation with our finances. Or, Father, maybe we're just showing you complete lordship in our lives. Father, some of us can't give this morning, and some of us may not be prepared to do that. And God, we definitely pray for all, Lord, that are giving or not giving this morning, that you are establishing lordship in their lives. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives. And for this, Lord, we just give you the praise. Bless this offering in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You are my strength. The Lord is my rock. my fortress, and my savior. My God is my rock in whom I find protection. He is my shield, the power that saves me in my place of safety. I called on the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and he saved me from my enemies. The ropes of death entangled me. Floods of destruction swept over me. The grave wrapped its ropes around me, and death laid a trap in my path. But in my distress, I cried out to the Lord. Yes, I prayed to God for help. He heard me from his sanctuary. My cry to him reached his ears. And then the earth quaked and trembled. The foundations of the mountains shook. They quaked because of his anger. Smoke poured from his nostrils. Fierce flames leaped from his mouth. Glowing coals blazed forth from him. He opened up the heavens and came down. Dark storm clouds were beneath his feet. Mounted on a mighty angelic being, he flew, soaring on the wings of the wind. He shrouded himself in darkness, veiling his approach with dark rain clouds. Thick clouds shielded the brightness around him and rained down hail and burning coals. The Lord thundered from heaven. The voice of the Most High resounded amid the hail and burning coals. He shot his arrows, scattered his enemies. His lightning flashed, and they were greatly confused. Then at your command, O Lord, at the blast of your breath, the bottom of the sea could be seen, and the foundations of the earth were laid bare. He reached down from heaven, and he rescued me. He drew me out of the deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemies, from those who hated me or were too strong for me. They attacked me in a moment when I was in distress, but the Lord supported me. He led me to a place of safety. He rescued me because he delights in me.
All the cries of the Southern cross, I stand on love and ground.
you unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies. Till all my fears are gone, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
So we're going to sing one more time, just a few of these words.
kneel as you're led or pray from your seat. We're going to enter into the spirit of prayer as a people.
You split the seas and walk right through it. Can you drop our fears in front of you?
Close to them, and that you would touch their bodies, that you would strengthen them. where there's weakness, that you would give peace where there is discomfort. But may they sense and feel your arms of love around them and your presence with them there in their homes. We pray you'd be with Gary. We are so thankful, Father, that he came through surgery. Good. Infection is gone. His spirit, Father, is wonderful. And for him to say the other day, you know, it's really a mind thing. I'm not going to be depressed because every day that I open my eyes, every day that I breathe is another day. Oh, Father, could we remember that every day that we put our feet on the floor and that we are able to breathe and wake up, that it's another day of an opportunity to serve you. It's another day to be Christ to those around us. So we ask, Father, that you continue to strengthen Gary. Continue as he goes through his therapy, that make him stronger and make his knees stronger. And I know he is anxious to get back to church and to be here with your folks and to be here to worship you. And so we ask for a special touch upon him. We pray, Father, for those of our number that are having some life-changing moments, some decisions to make. We pray for your direction, Father, upon them. It would be nice sometimes if we could see the writing on the wall. But you, Father, are the ones that have called each of us. And you're the one that guides us and directs us. And so we ask for your voice to be heard in all the decision making and everything, Father, would be to give you glory and praise. We pray for our pastor and his wife as they travel back to us today, that you would give them a safe flight and that you would bring them back to us refreshed and renewed to us this afternoon. And for all of the happenings today, the happenings this week, Father, we rejoice that we have the opportunity to do that. And so we ask that you anoint each part today. We pray for your anointing on Pastor Kyle as he brings to us the message that you have laid on his heart today, that you would speak through him. And may each of us be open to what it is that you have for us. Something new, maybe, out of the scripture we've read many, many times. But may we be seeking your face and seeking your will today as Pastor Kyle brings to us the message. We pray for each one around these altars this morning, Father. Whatever the need is, we just pray that you would hear their prayer and that you would intercede for them. And that they would pray in faith, believing that you hear and you will answer their prayers. Be with us in the continuance of the service, Father, and may everything that is said and done be to glorify your name. And it's in your name we give you praise and thanksgiving.
For leading us in prayer, Pastor Candy. The way the Spirit, the words the Spirit was leading you to say were words similar to what the Spirit was leading me to say to me. So I think we know He's here, and glad to be in His presence. when I was a kid. Oh, Pastor Barb is standing up. That means she is waiting for something. And that means kids, you guys, can head with Pastor Barb. I was a children's pastor for a lot of years, and I did the exact same thing, and I ended up coming back, so thanks for not doing that. I almost forgot. When I was a kid, I was allowed to ride my bike all over town. I lived in a small town, 10, 12,000 people, and we had a lot of freedom to just go and be out in the town. And I remember some Saturdays or some summer days where I would hop on my bike in the morning and we'd be gone all day long. We would just ride and ride and ride. If I was instructed, then I would call home at some point during the day. I would stop at a restaurant or a gas station or a hardware store or just whatever was close by, and I would ask if I could use the phone, and I would call home to just check in. But my friends and I would be out on our bikes, and we'd be gone all day long, and this was just normal. And probably a lot of us grew up with this sort of free reign of the place where we grew up. We just our parents were comfortable just kind of letting us go out and be. If you grew up in a town anything like mine. And my mom, actually, she even tells a story where she was 4 years old and would walk through the woods like a mile to get to school by herself. So anybody have, I'm seeing hands back there, like, yes, I walked 6 miles to school uphill both ways in the snow. And we hear stories like that, and I can't imagine letting my four-year-old walk by herself anywhere beyond just the outside of, you know, like to the sidewalk in the front of the house. But this was pretty normal. This environmental psychologist named Roger Hart actually decided to study this in the 70s. He went to this little town in Vermont. This little town had 86 children. And Roger Hart realized that we knew more about baboons and how they acted than we knew about how children acted when they were alone. And so he moved and immersed himself in this little town in Vermont, and he decided he was going to study how children acted when parents weren't around, and he was going to create this whole new kind of science around this. And he got permission from all of the parents in the town to follow their children pretty much everywhere. Like I said, there were 86 kids, and for 2 years, he studied these kids. He went everywhere with them. He even made physical maps. Like this one, we've got a map right here. This is children's paths and shortcuts that Roger Hart actually made in the 70s. You can see those thick black lines, those are paths that kids used that adults never used. So this was interesting. These are paths that only kids took, because, you know, kids find ways to cut through and under fences and through trees and things like that that adults never would do. So he's studying these kids and coming up with really cool maps like this, right? Well, the one thing that he found out was that kids had total free reign of this town. They had huge circles where they were allowed to go without their parents. They were allowed to just be. Actually, we have another map, again, that Roger Hart made. Let's throw that one up there. Those circles, like you'll see a tiny little box that is a house, and then a thick black line is how far a kid was allowed to go. And he found that these circles were giant, half mile, full mile, giant circles. And some houses, like the one at the top, he just put a star next to. And this was, my kid has free reign of the town, can go anywhere, has no boundaries. He ran into this all the time. This was normal in this little town in the 70s in Vermont. So fast forward, he goes back years later to this town to study the children of the children to see what has changed, what's different now. So he's back now in the 90s studying in this town, and what he finds is pretty crazy. The biggest difference studying the children of the children was that these huge circles and these huge spaces that kids were allowed to go had shrunk and shrunk and shrunk until most of the new maps that he drew, I don't have access to the new maps to show you, I'm sorry, but most of the new maps that he drew were about as big as the yard surrounding the house. Children were no longer allowed to go out, and they no longer had this free reign of the town. Thought this was really interesting, so he's interviewing parents, and parents are citing one reason why kids aren't allowed to go. And that one reason is fear. Fear that something bad will happen to them. All parents are afraid that something terrible is going to happen to their kids, so their kids, you can take that map down now, so their kids aren't allowed to go very far. And he's asking about what's going on, and he's trying to figure out, he can't get any hard numbers from anybody, and he starts to do studies of the statistics, and he realizes, statistically, crime is down. Okay? Actually, right now in America, all these crime statistics, like kids getting hit by cars, and juvenile homicide rates, and kidnappings under 18, all these terrible things, are lower today than they were 20 years ago. Can you believe it? We all, like, we think the world is much scarier now than it used to be, but statistically, actually all these terrible statistics are down now. But that didn't matter to people. They were still afraid. They were afraid of what might happen to the kid, to their kids. It happens to me too, like letting my kids just wander off on their own. I wouldn't do that now. I don't have any statistics to back up my fear. I'm just scared that something might happen. I'm so focused on what might happen, what could happen, that I lose sight on what has happened, which includes safety. So far, they've always been safe. There's been a drop in statistics, those bad things that could happen. We have made wise parenting choices. We've taught them well, and God has never left us, ever. That's what has happened. Why does that not inform what will happen for me? In this Lenten journey, as we face the cross, and when Ash Wednesday, we're reminded of our mortality. We have to remember the big picture and let what has happened inform what will happen. You turn with me to Exodus chapter 17. If you don't have it, if you don't have your own Bible, that's okay. We're going to put it up on the screen, and I'm going to read it out loud as you follow along. Exodus chapter 17, verse 1. And will you stand with me for the reading of God's Word? I'm reading from the New Living Translation, so it could look a little different from yours. Exodus 17, verse 1. At the Lord's command, the whole community of Israel left the wilderness of Sin and moved from place to place. Eventually, they camped at Rephidim, but there was no water there for the people to drink. So once more, the people complained to Moses. Give us water to drink, they demanded. Quiet, Moses replied. Why are you complaining against me? Why are you testing the Lord? But tormented by thirst, they continued to argue with Moses. Why did you bring us out of Egypt? Are you trying to kill us, our children, our livestock with thirst? And Moses cried out to the Lord, what should I do with these people? They're ready to stone me. And the Lord said to Moses, walk out in front of the people. Take your staff, the one you used when you struck the water of the Nile, and call some of the elders of Israel to join me. I will stand before you on the rock at Mount Sinai. Strike the rock. And people and water will come gushing out, and the people will be able to drink. So Moses struck the rock as he was told, and water gushed out, and the elders looked on. And Moses named the place Massa, which means test, and Meribah, which means arguing, because the people of Israel argued with Moses and tested the Lord by saying, is the Lord here with us or not? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We recite our motto together. Heavenly Father, I give you permission to speak to me, to speak through me, to do whatever you want with my life. I trust the leadership of your Holy Spirit. All right, you guys can take a seat. So this is a pretty famous Moses story. We've probably all heard it before. God's people need water, and God provides it in an unexpected and miraculous way by bringing it forward from a rock. And I can talk about all the things the passage could teach us for weeks. Like, we could stay on this one passage and talk about God's provision for us in ways for which we are unprepared, and the way God works miracles by drawing water from a source that does not produce water. The passage has a lot to teach us about who God is and about who we are. Our focus is a little bit on who we are today, mostly on our inability to see the big picture. So to understand chapter 17, we have to look back at chapters 15 and 16 because they work together in this big story arc, okay? There are three chapters before that, God's people crossed the Red Sea. God delivered their victory and the escape over the Egyptians, and after 3 days travel, 3 days, past the Red Sea, they get to a river and they're ready to take a drink, and the water is too bitter and not drinkable. and they cry out to God. And God points Moses to a piece of wood. This is an interesting story. And Moses throws the piece of wood into the river, and the water goes from bitter to drinkable. And then that's chapter 15. In the next chapter, chapter 16, into their desert wandering, and they're hungry, and they're so hungry they begin to long for life back in Egypt as slaves. That's not hungry, that's hangry. You know what hangry is? That's when you're so hungry you're angry. If you want a good example of being hangry, you can look at the Israelites in Exodus 16, or you can come to my house half an hour before any mealtime. And you can see some real hanger in action. Anybody get hangry?
I do.
Okay. A lot of hangry folks in here, so I won't keep you too long. So get some food in you. Being hangry makes us do weird things. They said, if only we had died back in Egypt. At least there was meat to eat. And instead, you have brought us out of this desert, and now we're starving. They're so hungry that they're longing for life back in slavery. And what does God do? He answers with manna every morning and quail every evening. Again, God shows up in miraculous ways. Manna comes from the sky. Manna is a Hebrew word. It means, what is it? So there's a miracle for you. They ate what is it for 40 years. Unexpected provision from God. Then we come to chapter 17. Again, the Israelites end up in a place with no water, and again, they begin fighting and complaining, and again, God shows up when Moses calls out to him, and this time, water comes out of a rock. So, these three chapters, like I said, are a story arc and have to be read together, because in all three, we see God providing, and in all three, we see Israel fretting. They saw God's awesome power. And he turns the Nile into blood on their behalf before this story. He rains down plague after plague and breaks loose generations of chains and sets them free. And just days, literally days, after one of God's most epic encounters with his people where he parts the Red Sea, they're complaining that there's nothing to drink and they're worrying about their survival. The Israelites are taking on this kind of Pharaoh stance where they challenge God's ability to show up. And like with Pharaoh, God proves himself to them over and over. And like Pharaoh, they are not convinced. Their faith is small and their fear looms large. That's really the problem. They're dominated by fear. They're no longer slaves to the Egyptians, but they are still slaves to their fear. And at each turn, God provides for them. And then the very next time they face any sort of trial at all, they're back to assuming that they're going to die. There's no water, chapter 15. There's no food, chapter 16. There's no water, chapter 17. God spends all of Exodus displaying his power and his favor, constantly delivering the people that he calls his own, keeping them from the jaws of death. And they complain about rations, fearing starvation. And they complain, they run away from the promised land, fearing giants. And they build a golden idol while Moses is on the mountain, fearing that their leader will never come down. God saves his people, and every time they run into a new situation, they seem to forget that God saved them the last time. The whole book of Exodus is almost like God jockeying for position as their God, because fear seems to be the God that they pay the most attention to. When God sent manna in chapter 16, he gave very specific instructions to the Israelites to only gather enough for one day, one omer, or about 2 quarts of this crispy, honey-tasting bread. Of course, some of them decide to gather extra. What if God doesn't show up tomorrow? And they gather extra bread, and by the next morning they go to eat it, and it's rotten. Because God is teaching them a very simple lesson. He will provide. Gathering more than what they needed was them trying to rely on their own efforts to get through. And it was fear that they wouldn't be fed that was driving them. And God said, I can be trusted anew every single day. Maybe this is a lesson for our own time in the desert. Because do you identify with the Israelites here? Do we rely on our own ability to save ourselves? Do we let fear that we won't be provided for dominate our thinking and our actions instead of allowing ourselves the freedom to rely on Jehovah Jireh, God, my provider? Do we forget what He has done for us and instead worry about what He might not do? I read this book when I was a kid. I read a lot of books as a kid. One really stands out to me because it was so terrible. I don't even remember where I got it, and I don't remember who wrote it or what it was called. I just remember what I took away from it. In this book, it was super awful, which I'm going to welcome you into the world of this terrible book for a second. In this book, the parents drop the kids off in an amusement park, and the kids are going to go play at this amusement park all day long while the parents are out doing whatever. And while the kids are playing at the amusement park, the parents have a car accident and die. Yeah, super sad. Then the kids come out of the amusement park at the end of the day, and they sit and they wait and they wait and they wait for the parents to come pick them up, and the parents never show up. And eventually it grows dark, and they're waiting and waiting, and finally police officers show up and tell them the terrible news, and these kids have to go live in the family. Okay. Everybody feeling good now? I know! Who let me read this? I don't know where I got it. I got it from some dark, twisted library somewhere. I really wish I had read it because, man, this story stuck with me. And I remember specifically right around this time, I developed this separation anxiety with my parents. And I began to think, every time they left, I began to think that they weren't coming back. Now, it was like fifth grade, somewhere in there. And I started just thinking, this book would just like dominate my thinking. And every time they left, I thought about this book and thought, am I going to be sitting outside waiting for them to pick me up and they're not going to show? And I remember for a couple of years, I dealt with this separation anxiety that you often see in younger kids, and I was dealing with it like in late elementary and early junior high because I remember this book kind of kicking it all off. My parents had always come back. My parents had always come through for me. Yet here I sat day after day after day thinking that next time they weren't coming back. Next time they're not going to come through.
Was this a children's book?
This was a children's book. It was a children's chapter book, and I think there was some lesson somewhere in there about family taking that. I don't remember the rest of it. All I remember is the terrible first five chapters. I know. Pre-read your kids' books. At least flip through them. See what they're about to read. The other day, we were at a store, and I had just turned the corner, from a clothing aisle, and I was looking at something for a minute, and Lucy, my six-year-old, came running out the aisle, looked both ways, looking frantic, and she saw me, and I kind of caught her eye, and she came running down the aisle, and she threw her arms around me. And she said, "I thought you left." I've never left her anywhere. She's never been left. She's never been left alone or forgotten or cast aside. Maybe our natural place is this fear. And it's through a relationship with Jesus that we get to overcome. We are fearful for our lives. We're fearful for our safety, for our comfort. And then we choose to take matters into our own hands. What can we do to get over being fearful? What can we do to make sure that none of these bad things happen? Because we live in a society where pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps and being self-made men and women is almost idolized. And when we choose to respond to fear with our own solutions instead of going to the one who made us and who has led us this far, then we are responding like the Israelites all over again. Are you fearful that God won't provide for you everything that you need? Are you trying to fill holes in your life with emotional holes and physical and financial with your own solutions? Where's our faith? Do we remember what God has done for us so far? Are we looking at the big picture? You're remembering the whole story? We often get caught up in this, what I call a recency bias, or what has God done for me lately? And then we're in this crisis, and our faith is really tested because we begin to forget the blessings as soon as trouble comes our way. Fear and the temptation to give into it clouds our faith. We're afraid that God won't come through. So we decide we have to come through for ourselves on our own. That's when we start gathering extra manna to make sure that we're going to have something to eat tomorrow instead of relying on the promise that He has given us. That's when we begin to build golden calves and worship something else because we feel like it's been too long since God showed up. This sort of lack of trust is rebellious thinking. Giving into fear is rebellion because every time I resign myself to letting fear dominate my thinking, which I struggle with, then I leave no room for the one who's brought me thus far. What needs to happen when I start to worry about finances? I remember that my family has never gone hungry and never been homeless. Why am I fretting about how much money we have or we're going to have? My family's always had everything that they need. What about when I worry that we haven't done enough as parents and we're not instilling the right values in our girls, or we missed some opportunity, some window where we were supposed to teach them something and we messed it up? What if they rebel? What if they don't love Jesus? That's the thing we want for them more than anything else. When I start to worry, I remember that during my tumultuous teenage years, Jesus never left me, not for a second. And I questioned my parents, and I questioned my faith, and I questioned the necessity and the validity of the church. And Jesus stayed by my side the whole time. I don't think my parents got every single thing right when they were parenting me, but the one to whom my mother prayed every day stuck with me and never left my side. Why then would I assume that He would not do the same for my own daughter? Why am I fearful? Why am I not looking at the big picture to see where He has led us so far? He's going to walk hand in hand with my daughter like He did with me. He leaves a legacy, and fear makes me want to ignore it. I will not let my fear dominate my thinking. I'm a child of the King. The story of His interactions with His people show Him coming through again and again and again. I don't think that He won't come through now. I don't want to be like the Israelites in the desert. At the first whiff of danger, they're back to assuming that God's not going to come through. He sent plagues to free them. He split the sea so they could walk right through it. He turned sweet waters of the Nile into blood. He turned the bitter waters of the Marah into sweet drinking water. He gave them manna every morning. He gave them quail every night. Yet here they are in Exodus 17 complaining to Moses that they don't have anything to drink. Hasn't God proven Himself by now? He's going to come through for them. He's so patient. Every time they complain, He delivers them because He loved them, because He delights in them, because they are His people and He is their God. We are God's people. He is our God. He delights in us. He's going to come through for you. It may not be what you're expecting. It may not be how you're expecting Him to come through. It may not even be what you're wanting. You may look around and see no evident solutions, but remember that the Israelites are in the desert without water. No evident solutions. And God made it flow from a rock. It may not be how we think He's going to deliver us, or how we want Him, or how we expect Him to deliver us, but He gives us what we need. He always comes through for us. And I mean that in an eternal sense. Don't let fear dominate. Don't let recency bias dominate. Don't forget the big picture. What has He done to bring you this far? I'm sure if I grabbed the microphone and I started walking around the room and I asked the question, what has God done for you thus far? We would have some amazing stories of God's faithfulness to his people. You might be in the desert right now, but don't forget the big picture. James Bryan Smith, he's one of my favorite authors. He's written some amazing books. He's one of the kind of authors where I reread his books. He's not a one time, he's an over and over kind of an author. And he says something, a big picture statement that really helps me. Actually, if we're Facebook friends, you may have seen it from me a few weeks ago. I posted it because it really struck me when I reread it. He says, I think about how often I focus on something I want God to do for me and neglect the 10,000 things, often better things, he has already done. I fuss about things little and large, like not having enough money to do this or that, or a problem at work, or a strain on a relationship, and I never once stop and thank God that I have eyes to see. If I lost my sight and I had $1 million, I would gladly pay it to get my eyesight back. My eyes are worth $1 million. So is my heart, my ears, my wife, my children. If I were wise, I would spend time each day thanking God for the vast treasure he has given me. I could start, but I could never stop. That's the kind of big picture thinking we need. To remember where we've come from and who has brought us here. Don't let fear that God won't come through for you cloud your story and make you forget how he already has. Don't be a slave to fear. Sweet, quenching water can flow from a rock in places we never expect. But we have to have the faith to know that God is not only capable of this, but is willing to draw water from the rock for us. We don't put our faith in fear. We don't put our faith in our abilities to pull ourselves out of a situation. Our faith is in the one who has provided for us thus far. And our faith is in the one who will continue to provide all that we need. We are no longer slaves to fear. It is not our God. It does not dominate us. We don't have to be like the Israelites. At every turn, every new danger, assuming that this is it, this is the time when God won't come through. Rather, you are free as people of God, as lovers of God, and as loved by God, you are free to know that, in fact, he will come through. What a freeing thing that is. Live in that reality. Let me pray for us. God, help us be big picture people. It's easy to stand and criticize the Israelites when we read about them, but I think we can all also identify with the simple fact that something comes up that puts fear in our hearts, and we've allowed it to reign for a while. And we've forgotten what you've done for us. But as a people, as individuals, you have brought us here. We sit before you in your presence. Help us to see that big picture so we are thankful for simple things like our spouses or our eyes or our family, our jobs. When we get caught up in things that would be fearful, help us to look back and see how you have carried us. So that we can have faith to know that you will continue to carry us. We trust you. We love you. Thanks for walking with us, delivering us from from a slavery, a bondage to fear. Amen. Will you stand with me? And receive this blessing as we pray. People of God, don't let fear be your master. Don't be in bondage to thinking that God won't come through for you. Don't be in bondage to thinking that only you can pull yourself out. God has brought you out of chains, through the sea, and He will provide for you in the desert. Put your faith in Him and in His provision. And as you go, may the peace of Christ be with you.
Go in
peace.